Hello, everyone. It is so great to be in a room of so many wonderful people committed towards sustainability. For me, it's like being in a room of Highlanders gathering on sacred ground, you know, for the revolution. And because of that, I'm actually not really going to talk about the past. I think we're all fully aware of the challenges we face and how much work there is to be done. And I'd like to focus instead on the future. And others are doing this. McKinsey recently, with the Center for the Encouragement of Corporate Philanthropy, they did a study as to what our future may look like. And that very insightful report boiled down to four choices. The first of which is corporations, these brands, they're going to respond to these expectations for greater social responsibility. And government's going to support them, and we're going to address these issues at scale. Secondly, corporations are going to try, but consumers won't trust them, and so governments will add regulation, which will add to expenses, and it'll discourage the whole process, and we'll end up with this sort of bifurcated system, much like in some ways that we have right now. Thirdly, companies will refuse to work for global change, government will force regulation on them, consumer distrust will rise, and then finally, society and corporations cannot match expectations, creating a downward spiral of social responsibility plus economic, environmental, and social decline. So it's kind of like smiley face at the top, not so smiley face underneath, not smiley face at all at number three, and sort of home alone on the last one, which is really doesn't bode well for our future. So what I'm interested in is how are we going to achieve number one? As somebody who's worked with large brands for the last 15 years, I know that there are competing interests between how they must serve the bottom line and how they should serve issues larger than themselves. But here's the realization that all parties are coming to. Prosperity is not the wealth of a few, but the well-being of many. The way we are practicing capitalism right now is simply unsustainable, let alone unconscionable. So, how is this starting to manifest itself? As Koan mentioned, we see this wave of revolution sweeping through the Arab world that continues in Syria and continues even in Egypt, which had so much success as they fight back against the sort of the sentencing of the two sons of President Mubarak. Even domestically, we see the Occupy Wall Street movement. But beyond that, we start to see consumer activism, whether it was, you know, Bank Transfer Day, Bank of America's, you know, debit card fee, the online fee by Verizon for paying online, whether it was SOPA or PIPA, consumers at home are going, wait a second, we can talk to each other. And we can talk back to our brands. And if you want us to vote for you with our dollars, we want you to be more socially responsible. And at its most extreme, both parties are being emboldened by cyber activism, where rightly or wrongly, parties like Anonymous and WikiLeaks are saying, I'm sorry, but that whole thing about transparency, you don't have a choice. And that's important for brands, because there is nowhere to hide. So you're faced with a very, very real decision between trying to bury things deeper, only to be exposed, or to rise to the challenge of authenticity, accountability, and transparency. So each of these parties is rising to a challenge which is based on the realization that we now live in an intimately connected and mutually dependent global community. 2008 to me was that wake-up call. What happened on Wall Street affected Main Street, affected our hopes, our housing, our healthcare. It affected Greece, it affected Iceland, it affected the stock market in the Gulf states. The same is true today. Here we are 4 years later after that crisis, and we're all quaking in our boots as we watch Greece and Spain teeter on collapse and watch the stock market plummet on Friday and even further today. How far have we moved in that short 4 years? Not far enough. And consumers are deeply passionate about this change. They not only want it, they will drive brands' acceptance of it. And the next three slides aggregate some of the key facts from some of the latest reports in this area, and I'll give you an email for all these slides later on. You don't need them, but I only want to share three facts. The one on the right here. Could everybody here, on just here to the left here, to my left, your right, raise your hand? Could everyone raise your hand this side of the room? Look at them. That's 30% of the room. Most consumers don't care if 70% of brands disappear. You are absolutely free to perish at your leisure, all of you. Your customers do not care. Secondarily, on the left, your left, my left, your right, 50% of global consumers believe that they can actually make a company be more socially responsible. Again, think about this layering of empowerment that's going on between citizen activism, consumer activism, cyber activism, the values proposition that informs a millennial's worldview, their innate connectedness and technology sort of fluency. They are looking at the world and saying, I want our own future, not my parents' past. And you either are part of that future or you're going to fall by the way of Blockbuster, Borders, and any of those other household names that have now disappeared. And then thirdly, 71% believe that brands and consumers can make a greater contribution to social causes by working together. So they want to work with you. They want to be part of a co-creative process. So think about that. I mean, I'm from the age of advertising where we did focus groups and you get 20 people in a room and ask them about pizzas and you say, do you want the cheese pizza or do you want the cheese pizza with more cheese or the cheese with the triple cheese? And they'd all talk about it and we make decisions. We have a real-time focus group going on comprised of billions of people on a daily basis who are saying, we want to be partners with you in scaling change. And if you do that, we will support your business in return. That's the transaction they're offering you if you're willing to accept it. And that's why I deeply believe the future of profit is purpose. Not just because purpose is innately good, but because purpose is the market driver right now. This is what will build your business. I'm a lawyer ad guy. I'm everything you hate in other people. This is not about doing good for good's sake. This is about responding to the marketplace peculiar to this moment in time and how it's being impacted by technology. And here are the rewards. You know, all these years working with big brands, the number one issue they face and spend fortunes on resolving is who are they? What does the company stand for? What does it mean to employees, to their customers? And if they don't know what that is, it impacts everything. Yet at the same time, if they do know what it is, it's a gift that keeps on giving because it gives you clarity of focus and strategy. Because you can not only tell your customers who you are, but it can inform what region should I go into? What technology should I adopt? Should I copy my competitor or not? In this crazy, fast-changing marketplace, you cannot be all things to all people. You need to be your own compass, in which case your purpose is incredibly valuable to your bottom line internally as well as externally and its impact on the world. Secondarily, that purpose is so meaningful to your employees. We all know it's so much more expensive to get a new employee than it is to keep one. And we know it's so hard to attract the top talent here in the United States, where there is an education gap right now. And so how do you attract and keep and make productive the best talent you have? Purpose is a critical way to do that. Then thirdly, consumer goodwill and trust and loyalty. By aligning around shared values and working together, you as a brand make yourself more meaningful to your customers' lives, which makes you more relevant, which means you actually keep their attention longer than the next shiny squirrel over here in this ADD technology-driven culture. And then finally, brand awareness, PR, engagement. You know, social media is just another channel through which to manage your reputation and generate word-of-mouth advertising. These are two timeless issues for a brand, and purpose is very, very powerful, especially in the context of a long-term struggling economy here and overseas. So who's listening? I mean, 3 or 4 years ago when I started writing We First and moved into this area, it was still a tentative sort of conversation. Is social media a fad? Should we leverage it and do something meaningful? These are the brands that are participating now. It's a fait accompli. This is done. The revolution has begun. It's your choice whether you participate or not and whether you're one of the leaders that will benefit from the results. And we're finally at that point we can actually quantify that assertion, in the sense that Jim Stengel, the former global CMO of Procter & Gamble, just came out with a book called Grow, and he announced the Stengel 50, which are those companies in which he established a direct connection, a cause-effect connection between the higher purpose of the brand and its growth, its bottom line. To the point that if you'd invested in those 50 companies over the last 10 years, your return would be 400% that of the S&P 500. Or, by a similar token, Harvest Media's Meaningful Brands Report, which came out at the end of last year, which examined those brands that were most meaningful to their customers in terms of their contribution to individual and collective well-being. And these were the top 20 companies. These are the metrics by which purposeful engagement are now being measured that are increasingly driving bottom-line success. So here's the new dynamic. The success of your business will be in direct proportion to the emotional impact on your customers. That's fairly timeless. That's just fundamental to advertising. But that emotional impact will be directly proportional to the social impact of your purpose. That's a new player in this equation. And then finally, that social impact will be in direct proportion to the success of your business, because obviously the bigger you are, the more you can do to improve things, the greater social impact you'll have. This is the virtuous circle that will keep on giving and driving the success stories in business and branding in the years to come. So how do we get there? This is a room full of wonderful sustainability officers who are already leading this revolution. I would challenge you to expand your definition of sustainability, because if you do not, you will not go to the heart of the practice of capitalism and will forever be playing catch-up to negative externalities, mixed motives, competing interests within the private sector. So what does that mean? It has to be economically sustainable. This pillar and post boom crash cycle that we see going on today again on the stock market is simply unsustainable because the cost to too many people is too extreme. Socially sustainable, whether it's headache-inducing pollution in China or walled slums in Brazil or chronic unemployment in the United States, we need to do a better job of creating societies that can actually thrive and succeed. Then it needs to be morally sustainable. It is simply unconscionable that so many people die of preventable diseases on a daily basis and that we continue to add to the ranks of the poor every day in this world. It's unconscionable and it has to stop. And it needs to be ethically sustainable in the sense that you need to impose that intention on people and enforce it with the rule of the law. And you see great progress being made there by companies like B Corporations. And then obviously it needs to be environmentally sustainable. And how do you achieve those five different expressions of sustainability? Well, you have to identify what your core values are as a company. And here's a suggestion of seven core values that could be meaningful to your brand. Sustainability in all five senses. Fairness of reward. The suppliers, you know, the employees, the investors and management, they all need to share fairly in the spoils of a company. And we need to temper this chronic disproportion between the income of CEOs in the United States and the average employee, especially compared to Europe. Fiscal responsibility. A brand has to be responsible for the mistakes it makes and the negative externalities, the impact it has on the environment out there as a byproduct of making the products which drive their business success. We have to be accountable in terms of transparency. This is not a choice, it's not a luxury anymore. It will be imposed on you if you don't volunteer it. And I think what Patagonia does with the Footprint Chronicles is a great example of how you get ahead of that issue. You need to be purposeful. Beyond your own brand, beyond your own product category, beyond your own industry, to larger issues. How do you lead in a global community? You demonstrate a commitment to issues larger than your own bottom line or self-interest. That's how you demonstrate a commitment to a global community and establish your leadership. Engagement. You need to invest in relationships, longer-term relationships, than just the short-term. And that's very hard to do when incentive schemes haven't changed, when the board of directors are still rewarded and stock options on the basis of hitting analyst projections for the next quarter. It's very difficult. But even in Northern Europe now, we're starting to see where directors are being rewarded in direct proportion to the reduction of the carbon footprint of their company. So new metrics, new dynamics are being put in place. And then finally, global citizenry. You need to be a steward for the well-being of the planet, because we're in this together, ecologically, but also currency-wise, economically, and on every level, as we've discovered since 2008. So how do we do this? How do we structure it? How does it play out if we put our shoulder behind this branded revolution? There are three parts. The first is this fundamental partnership between brands and consumers, where there's this transaction. You get the consumer's goodwill, loyalty, and trust, and they'll buy your stuff if you, in return, are more socially responsible. And this is a co-creative process, and there's numerous examples of this out there now. Secondly is a concept I call contributory consumption, but it builds on the wonderful work of Product Red and 1% for the Planet, where a small proportion of contribution is built into the sale of every product. But let's expand that. Let's take advantage of the opportunity that technology is providing. Let's expand it to retail, credit card, online, mobile, and virtual transactions. Americans will spend $6 billion a year on little virtual goods, digital things that don't exist, to put in non-existent farms, on gaming platforms, inside social networks in 2014. We wonder why we're economically in trouble. But if you think about that, if we only took a fraction of the sales of all the transactions on these five levels, if you actually only took 1 cent on the dollar of all the transactions on all these five levels in only 5% of the private sector globally, you would absolutely dwarf the $14 billion raised by corporate foundations every year. That's the power of working together incrementally to fund and scale change. And then on the third level is something I call a global brand initiative. But this is just a simple idea of us all working together. We see more and more examples of this now, and for example, the Sustainable Apparel Coalition led by Patagonia, but where otherwise competitors and even cross-sector, these companies are working together to scale social change in and around climate change and many other issues. So let's imagine for a second we had an issue of clean water in a given region. What could BASF, Nike, Coca-Cola, Apple do if they all work together to address that problem? Just imagine what's possible if each of these companies chose to work together and to bring to bear on these issues not only the funding that came from contributory consumption, but technology, training, infrastructure, marketing, and distribution. What could we achieve at scale, systemically, and sustainably? And then imagine those three parts come together and work with government and nonprofits, so that we've got a third pillar of social change to help out government and philanthropy. Because we all need to know what we know, and we need to know what we don't know. And NGOs know, and foundations understand the realities on the ground better. And government can help with the regulatory aspects. But imagine we had those three pillars of social change, with the might of the private sector as like a turbine engine behind this river of change. And then imagine those three parties address the key issues facing our planet in the larger sense of sustainability. Everything from hunger to healthcare to education, child mortality, and disease. So we create a sustainable ecosystem, sustainable cultures, a sustainable way of living as a global community. So when I think about this revolution that Coan and Sustainable Brands is spearheading, I feel that the nature of revolution itself has changed. The evolution of revolution is now contribution. And I want us all to engage our pathologically self-interested competitive instincts in the service of purpose. It's not about the money. It's about the purpose you're trying to achieve. And if you do that authentically, then you will be rewarded in terms of your bottom line. And so I inspire all of us to embrace the role that we have earned by being in this room, which is to be leaders. Leaders is not a position within, leadership is not a position within inside your company, within inside your industry, within inside the whole private sector. Leadership is a sense of shared responsibility. Every one of us has a shared responsibility in this room. Internally, that means you challenge your company to embrace this expanded definition of sustainability, all five levels. You challenge your company to take what it's learned and share it with your competitors, because you're stronger together than you are alone. And then you challenge different industries to work together, work cross-sector, so that we can scale social change and accelerate it so we can see the results in our lifetime. If you do that, you will not only stem the tide of the worst excesses of capitalism that are not only hurting the planet but ultimately damaging our businesses, but you will experience the personal satisfaction that comes from a unique brand of success that is sustainable, that is scalable, and that has profound significance. If you would like these slides, just email slides@wefirstbranding.com, use them as your own, and thank you so much for playing a part in this revolution. If you have any questions, I'll be outside later on. I'm signing copies of We First at 1 o'clock at the Sustainable Brands bookstore. It's such a pleasure to be here with you, and thank you to Coanne for inviting me.